In this lecture, I am going to discuss on complex representation of passband signal. Basically, a passband signal can be represented in terms of an equivalent baseband signal using complex representation. Signal can be represented in terms of an equivalent baseband signal. Using complex representation. This is the underlying point that you have to remember from your previous knowledge in analog communication. That is, such signals are very conveniently described in terms of complex representation. For the convenience that it gives, we will continue to use that complex representation. Okay, so before we enter into this process, let us try to understand what we mean by a baseband signal and what we mean by a passband signal. Okay, so baseband signal. Okay, a baseband signal is a signal which have most of the energy or practically all of the energy concentrated around a zero carrier frequency or zero frequency, meaning for example, if you take a voice signal, let us say the signal exists from 0 hertz to 4 kilohertz. And if you try to draw the spectrum of the signal, this is magnitude spectrum, 0 hertz, and this is frequency. It will be like this. Okay, 0 to 4 kilohertz. Okay. Since your voice signal is a real signal, it has negative frequency component also. If you take Fourier transform, you will come to know how it is minus 4 kilohertz comes. So this is the baseband signal, how it looks like. Now let us try to understand how your passband signal looks like. Your passband signal. This passband signal is also called a bandpass signal. Bandpass. So bandpass signal is a signal essentially which have most of the energy or practically all of the energy concentrated around a non-zero carrier frequency, meaning this is your spectrum frequency. So most of the energy of the passband signal is concentrated around a non-zero carrier frequency. Let me call this as F naught, and this is your carrier frequency. Okay, and this passband signal does not contain any frequency component at a zero frequency. Essentially, that is what I mean by passband signal. Since it's a real signal, you also have like this spectrum around minus F naught. So this is how your passband signal looks like, and this is how your baseband signal looks like. Okay, and this is your passband signal. Now let us go through the process how to represent a passband signal in terms of a complex baseband signal. We know that a complex number can be written as a plus J times B. Okay, so A is a real part and B is the imaginary part. In the same way, the complex baseband also, baseband representation also has real part and imaginary part. That is real signal, real part contains a certain signal and imaginary part contains another part of signal. So therefore, the baseband signal V of t contains real part. Let me call the real part as V sub R of t and the imaginary part V sub I of t. So this is my complex representation of a baseband signal. So this is baseband signal and this is your complex form, complex representation. So look at here, the baseband has a real part and imaginary part. Let me use some other color. This is your real part and this is your imaginary part. Imaginary part. The corresponding passband signal would be, suppose if you want to try to write the passband signal, the passband signal would be V tilde of t is equal to V R of t times cos of 2 pi f naught minus V sub I of t times sine of 2 pi f naught t. Now let me call this is equation number 1 baseband representation and this is the passband representation. So the passband representation of course is a real signal. Look at here, there is no imaginary part in this passband representation. So therefore the passband signal can be represented in terms of what is called an in-phase component and a quadrature phase component. I'm sure you have done all this. I'm just trying to remind you of these basic things. And this VR of t is sometimes called a in-phase modulation component. And this V sub I of t is also called a quadrature phase modulation component. In phase and quadrature refer to two sinusoids that have the same frequency and are 90 degree out of phase. When I say in phase and quadrature phase, it refers to two sinusoids in phase and quadrature phase refer to two sinusoids. Two sinusoids that have same frequency, but 90 degree out of phase. Okay, such a signals are called a in phase component or quadrature phase component. In the from equation number 2, you can observe that we have cos of 2 pi f naught t and sine of 2 pi f naught t. See, look at here, the frequency same here also and here also, the frequency is f naught. But these two signals differ only by 90 degree out of phase. So that is why these two components are called in phase modulation, modulating component, and this is quadrature modulation component. That's it. That's why the name, how the name comes from. Generally, the passband signals are denoted by either V tilde of T or they call V prime of T. Either way, you can stick. But many of the authors say V tilde of T. So let us follow that notation, V tilde of T. Now, what is the relation between equation number 1 and 2? 1 and 2 relation. What is the relation? Now you can easily observe that. So how do you go from equation 1 to 2 or 2 to 1? That is my question. Suppose you are given a passband signal. So how do you go to a baseband representation? Or a baseband signal is given to you. How do you move from baseband signal to a passband signal? And the important thing is to note down here is, in baseband we have complex representation and in the passband we have real representation. It's a real signal, right? In general, the passband signal is a real signal. Okay, so if you are look at an oscilloscope, it will exhibit both amplitude as well as phase modulation. Therefore, the relation between the passband signal and the baseband signal can be written as follows. The passband signal V tilde of T, which is equal to, you take the baseband signal V of T, multiply by e power some exponential terms, e power j 2 pi f naught of T, and take the real part of this product. So that will give you the passband signal. Okay, and here what is V of T? It is a passband signal, complex representation of, sorry, this is baseband signal. Now substitute here. So real part of this is V sub R of T plus J times V sub I of T multiply by e power J times 2 pi f naught of T, and using Euler's identity, e power j theta equal to cos theta plus j into sin theta, and multiply term by term and take the real part, you will end up with the passband signal, that is Vr of T cos of 2 pi f naught T minus Vi of T times sin of 2 pi f naught T. This is the connection between a passband signal, real passband signal, and a complex baseband signal. If you use some little bit of algebra and a trigonometric and a complex number, complex representation system, then you can rewrite this equation number 2 in some other compact form. Okay, let me do that. So that will give more intuition in this. So from equation 1, what is equation 1? Equation 1 is V of T is equal to Vi of T plus J times, is it V or this is Vr, right? Vr times J times Vi of T, right? Now, we know from our school mathematics that when you have the complex number Z, that is denoted by A plus Ib. And what is the modulus of this number? Which is square root of A square plus B square. And what is the phase angle of this complex number? Phi equal to tan inverse of B by A. So a complex number can be represented in many ways. I mean, this is called a rectangular form, or sometimes you can write it in the polar form, or you can write it in the exponential form. Okay, suppose if you write like this, mod of Z times the angle of A, and this is your polar form. Similarly, you can write mod of Z times e power j into phi, this is your exponential form. You can write in any one form, one and the same exponential form, right? The same concept that we are going to use it here. This is my V of T. It looks like A plus IB form. Take modulus of this V of T. If you take modulus, then square root of Vr square of T plus V sub I square of T, right? Then if you take the phase angle, instead of writing phi, I am going to write phi of t, because it is a function of t, that is why. So phi of t is equal to tan inverse of v sub I of t by v sub r of t. This is my phase. Now I am going to write this in the form of exponential. So mod of, so v of t I can write as mod of v of t times e to the power of j times phi of t. Okay, now Look at this one. What is this? Let me call this is equation number 3. Now substitute, let's say this is equation number 4. Substitute equation 4 in equation 3. Substitute equation 4 in equation number 3. Then you will have V tilde of t, which is equal to real part of V of t. You take magnitude, then e power j times V of t multiply by e power j times 2 by f naught t. So therefore this is going to be real part of, let me call this magnitude part as a of t. Let's say a of t times this is e power j phi of t and this e power j 2 pi f naught t. So I write e power j times 2 pi f naught t plus phi of t. Now see, this a of t is a real part, so I can pull out from this real. So a of t I can take it out, real part of this whole thing. I can write cos of 2 pi f naught t plus phi of t plus j times sine of 2 pi f naught t plus phi of t. Now take real part of that. So you have a of t times cos of 2 pi f naught t plus phi of t. Now look at this equation now. Let me call this as equation number, what is the previous equation number? 4, right? So let's say this equation number 5. So now I have written this equation in terms of cosine function purely, so that it contains both amplitude modulation and phase modulation. See here, the amplitude of let me choose some other color. See, the amplitude is modulated now, amplitude modulation. And here the phase also changes, right? So it says it contains that both phase modulation component and a phase modulation component. So therefore in general it will exhibit both amplitude as well as phase modulation. Now you may ask a question, why are we doing all these kind of things? So the reason why we use this kind of representation is basically for convenience. It is very convenient to represent in the baseband form rather than in passband form. For example, suppose you want to study the effect of phase offset. Phase offset at the receiver. Maybe the carrier at the receiver is not perfectly synchronized with the transmitted carrier. And in that case, you want to study the frequency offset also. And you want to study the effect of phase offset of them in the carrier or frequency offset in the carrier. So all you have to do is multiply this equation number 1 with the e power j theta or e power j times 2 pi f naught t. That is, we have v sub r of t plus j times v sub I of t. Multiply this guy with the e power j times theta. This will give you the phase offset effect of the receiver. Phase offset. Whenever you have some synchronization problem, whenever you may not have perfect synchronization with the transmitted carrier, then you want to study the phase offset, then you can do very easily in this method than doing the same thing in the passband representation. It's very easy, it's very convenient. That's it. That's what I'm trying to say here. Similarly, you take this VR of t plus j times VI of t. Multiply by the frequency offset content, e power j times 2 pi nu t. So this will give the frequency offset. How far away your frequency is from the carrier frequency, that you can study. Therefore, the complex representation is mathematically much more convenient to handle, and therefore it is preferred. So without going into messy trigonometric identities, which you will have to make use of if you are to continue to work with the real representation, it is very conveniently handled in the complex domain. This is one reason. Now let us see how we can obtain the complex baseband representation from the passband signal. So you have the passband signal V tilde of t, and this signal is received by the receiver. Okay, that is passband signal is, in the sense what I'm saying is, it's a modulated signal essentially, that's it. Okay, you have the modulated signal, so you get this modulated signal or passband signal and split into two part. Maybe I'll draw the diagram a little more clearly like this. You put a multiplier here, and here also put a multiplier. Incoming signal is divided into two parts. You have the oscillators. In this oscillator, and this is 2 times cosine of 2 pi f naught t. This is 2 times sine of 2 pi f naught t. And after this multiplication, low pass, this guys, low pass filter, and I'll end up with VR of t. And here also pass it through a low pass filter, and you have Vi of t. So this is nothing but the complex representation of a baseband signal. So this is a black schematic representation of how to obtain a complex representation of a baseband signal, passband signal. So all you have to do to obtain the complex representation is to obtain the in phase and the quadrature component. See, this is the in phase component, and this is the quadrature phase component. This component basically define the complex representation. So you take a passband signal V tilde of t and pass it through V tilde of t, and you multiply V tilde of t by cos of 2 pi f naught t, as well as its quadrature carrier sine of 2 pi f naught t. I already told you the definition of in phase and the quadrature. The frequency is same, but these two signals or two carriers are out of phase, 90 degree out of phase. And finally you give it to the low pass filter, and then you will obtain VR of t and V of t. It is a very simple exercise, you can verify. Maybe I'll work out one and remaining you can try yourself. So V tilde of t, so this V tilde of t is multiplied by 2 times cos of 2 pi f naught t. What is V tilde of t? V sub R of t times cos of 2 pi f naught t minus V sub I of t sine of 2 pi f naught t. The whole thing is multiplied by 2 times cos of 2 pi f naught t. Then you multiply here, so you'll get V sub R of t cos square of 2 pi f naught t. Then 2 comes, maybe I'll put the 2 here. Minus 2 times V sub I of t times cos of 2 pi f naught t and sine of 2 pi f naught t. Then this is 2 sine a cos a, so it's going to be sine 2 a formula, and there's a high frequency component, so it is completely removed to by the low pass filter. And here this V sub R of t 2 times 1 plus cos square theta equal to 1 plus cos 2 theta by 2, right? 1 plus cos of 4 pi f naught t holded by 2, and this 2 will get cancelled. So if you pass it through a low pass filter, you'll get V sub R of t. You are passing this both V sub R of t plus V sub R of t times cos of 4 pi f naught t. This is a high frequency content removed by the low pass filter. It has gone to, it will be eliminated. So therefore in the upper arm you will end up with only VR of t. And anyway, this is a high frequency component, sine 2a equal to 2 sine a cos a. So again, this is sine of 4 pi f naught t component. The whole thing will be rejected by the low pass filter. So you'll get one component of the baseband signal, V or a real part you'll get. Similarly, if you do the same exercise for the lower arm also, you'll get the answer. It is a practical method of, the above block diagram is a practical method of obtaining a complex representation. And then to continue to work with the complex representation in a physical real system. So this is, you know, used in practice. And a complex representation is not only for just mathematical convenience, that is convenience in mathematics, it all also introduces a lot of convenience in actual signal processing. Because in digital communication, what you do is once you receive the signal, then sample it and quantize it, and then you process it using DSP processors. Suppose, let us assume that you are doing the same process in the passband, then what will happen? In the passband, the frequency is very high. So you have to do the sampling at a very high frequency, you do the quantization and process it. It's a little more difficult and it is not very nice to do in a DSP processor, because the sampling rate is high and more number of samples are generated. But on the other hand, what you do is you do this process, bring back to, you know, baseband, so that your entire frequency, entire spectrum which is lying at F0 is shifted towards zero. So therefore, what happens, you are going to sample it at a low sampling rate, and it's easy for your DSP processor to process it also. So therefore, from the signal processing point of view, we should appreciate that. And one more thing also, we are not lost any information. See, from V sub R of T and V sub I of T, I can go back to V tilde of T. Therefore, I have not lost anything. I can go back to where I started from. That means I have not lost anything. And moreover, working in the baseband is very easy. It is a very important point if you decide to do digital signal processing on the signal, because you have to sample the waveform and then process it. Sampling and all that is taken care of much more easily, much more conveniently at a baseband than at a passband. Although one can sample in the passband, you can do that, but the sampling rate involved will be higher. But in the baseband, one can work with the low sampling rates. Therefore, efficiently make use of DSP processors, digital signal processors, which may not work at a very high frequency efficiently. And moreover, without loss of any information, you can represent it in the baseband. Okay, so I think there's a point to stop. Before that, I want to put one more point, like recall from your analog communication. So in analog communication, what we did is, let us take a DSB SC modulation. DSB SA modulation, double sideband suppressed carrier modulation. In this, what we did is, you take the message signal M of T, and then M of T is multiplied by the carrier cos of 2 pi F naught T. Okay, so this is your baseband signal. Let me write here, M of T is your baseband signal. Once you do the modulation, then the whole thing is called a passband signal. Now, what I do is, instead of taking only one M of T, let me say I have message signal M1 of T, and I multiply by cos of 2 pi F naught T. So this also M, or else let me write properly. So this is one scenario. So the other one is, one can think, why can't I use one more, way of doing the same thing? So what I do is, I have two mic. Let's say mic 1. I am getting from mic 1, I am getting M1 of T. And I have another mic, mic 2. I am getting M2 of T. And this signal, let's say this all are voice signal, okay? And here, I am going to do the modulation, DSB SA modulation here, cos of 2 pi F naught T. This is one signal I am getting. Now here, let me take another signal, M2 of T, and do the sine of 2 pi, same carrier, but 90 degree out of phase. And here I am getting another modulated signal. And I put a adder here, and this is minus, and this is. So here I am getting M1 of T times cos of 2 pi F naught T minus M2 of T times sine of 2 pi F naught T. So this is my passband modulation. This is my modulated signal, and this modulated signal is nothing but a passband signal. Because passband signal only we can transmit through sky, through an antenna. Therefore, this indicates a passband signal. whenever you do the modulation, you will end up with a passband signal. But at the receiver, you cannot process this passband signal as such. You have to do the down conversion. Once you do the down conversion, you will end up with a baseband signal. That baseband signal is very conveniently represented in complex form. That complex form only just now we discussed. Okay, this is the intuition involved in this. And I think there's a point to stop. So let me wind up in this lecture. And this is very useful for passband digital modulation techniques. So this passband digital modulation. So in the next lecture, we will discuss passband digital modulation. So in the passband digital modulation, we heavily use this passband representation of the signal and its equivalent term, baseband representation of the signal in complex form. So that is why I discussed this concept. So please be familiar with all this process, what we mean by baseband and what we mean by passband, and how to move from passband to baseband or baseband to passband. Baseband to passband is very simple. It's a modulation process. After all, suppose you have a baseband signal, how do you go to passband signal? You have a baseband signal, so how do you go to passband signal? You take the baseband signal, let's say V R of T, real part of the signal. Confusing this notation, let me say M1 of T, and you take another signal J times M2 of T. If you don't put J, then what will happen? These two signals will add up and mix each other. So J indicates this is completely different from that one, and you multiply by e power J times 2 pi F naught T and take the real part. It's a mathematical way of writing that set. In practice, what happened? This is a mathematical way, but in a practical circuit or in an electronic circuit, what happens? You take this, this is mathematical way of writing, because the theory is different from practical. That's why I'm giving this much stress on this. Mathematical representation. But in practice, what they do in general is you take M1 of T, that's what I discussed here. You take M1 of T, multiply by cos 2 pi f naught t, take m2 of t from mic 2, multiply sin 2 pi f naught t and subtract. This is plus and this is minus. Then finally end up with the passband signal. So that's how we move from passband signal to baseband signal and baseband signal to passband signal. So already I discussed how to move from your passband signal. This is your passband signal, passband, and this is your baseband. If you want to say in terms of practical viewpoint, then instead of calling VR of T, let me call this is message M1 of T, and this is, let me call message M2 of T. That's it. Okay, let me wind up this discussion at this point, and in the next lecture, we will discuss passband digital modulation. Thank you very much.